So it's my pleasure to introduce Daniel Whiteson. Daniel Whiteson and I have known each other for a long time. We overlapped as undergraduates at Rice University during a period that produced four faculty members and particle physics from a small institution. Daniel went on to UC Berkeley, where he was a postdoc, and then as a graduate student, and then at University of Pennsylvania as a postdoc. He worked at the Tevatron a lot, and then moved later on to the Large Hadron Collider and works on Atlas experiment together with our NYU group here. He's worked on a number of different things. He's very prolific. He's branched out from just experimental particle physics, also do dabble in phenomenology. He was tasked with helping co-convene the group's sort of big 5 to 10 year planning project, where he was convening the new particles working group, and he also has a very interesting set of like outreach efforts and things like that. I think you'll see some references to it. And this last year, he was awarded an APS fellowship, and I'd just like to read the citation because it kind of is a good example. It says, for leadership and searches for new physics and early studies in the top quark mass and cross section at the Tevatron and Large Hadron Collider, comma, both experimental and phenomenological, awkward construction, particularly searches for dark matter, innovative applications and ideas for machine learning, where he's really been a leader, and for non-traditional outreach efforts. So, I think we'll hear a little bit more about that. So, thank you very much, Daniel.
Thank you, Kyle. Hello, everybody. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be back here. So today I will be talking about none of the things that Kyle mentioned, because the most important thing you should know when we start this talk off about cosmic rays is that, unlike some of you in the audience, I am not an expert in cosmic ray physics. What I'll be talking about today is a fun side project that I'm investigating. So thank you for coming along on the ride. Most of the time, as Kyle mentioned, I'm an Atlas experimentalist, so I do particle collider physics, I search for dark matter, I do machine learning, sometimes I dabble in astrophysics, as you see. But my interest in physics extends well beyond the narrow set of questions for which I currently have funding, and I hope that resonates with people in the room. In fact, I think it's a very exciting time to do physics because there are so many open questions. We live in an era of precision ignorance where we know very well how little we know about the universe. And it's only a small exaggeration if you make a pie chart of the mass energy budget of the universe to say that most of the universe is something we don't know. And to me, that's very exciting. And it's exciting in the sense that it presents opportunities. And it's staggering to me how many basic open questions there are in physics. You know, questions which anybody, even without a PhD in particle physics, can understand the scope and the meaning of the question. What is space exactly? What is time? How big is the universe? How did the universe begin? A lot of these questions are still open questions, and they're accessible to everybody. And they emphasize our ignorance, right? But as scientists, I think we do too little of touting our ignorance. I think our ignorance is an opportunity because it's exciting. It's exciting because it means that there are discoveries ahead. And so I thought this was interesting and important enough that I actually wrote a book, which is coming out in a few weeks, together with a cartoonist, Jorge Cham, that expresses the excitement of our ignorance of all of these open questions. And I hope that it encourages people to think and read about physics. Okay, and the reason I think it's exciting is because these questions have answers. Unlike accessible open questions in philosophy or morality, for which people will be still smoking banana peels and discussing in 500 years, these questions in physics have hard and fast answers, answers that we could actually discover that can change the way we think about the human situation, our relationship with the universe. It may be that in a few hundred years, graduate students are looking back and saying, boy, I wish I had been around in, you know, the 2000s when they figured out all these really critical things that changed the way we look at the universe, right? This could be the golden age of physics. And I really hope that major discoveries await us and that they come soon. Okay, so I set the scale very large. These are big open questions in physics, right? So how do we actually approach them? How do we start figuring these things out? Well, one thing to do is do the research you're funded for and do it well. That's certainly true. But another way is send an email. So that's how this lesson started. And I'm going to start this by showing you the chronological nature of this project because I want to emphasize the approach we're taking to it, which is let's try to figure this out. So in my group, every 6 months or so, we have a meeting I call the Crazy Ideas Meeting, where everybody has to come with two ideas for a new project. no limits on how much it'll cost or whether it's at all feasible. Propose an accelerator the size of the solar system you like, something that answers a deep and big question about the universe. And it's a good exercise for my students to think creatively and propose stuff. So this is the email I sent them, asking them to come up with some ideas. And I really wanted to emphasize raw pie-in-the-sky brainstorming. All right. And you guys are good at this also. There's several people in this department come up with new ways to do things that are outside the mainstream of their background or their interests. Kyle figured out a way to check a loophole on the Higgs-Lep search, and Glennis has fun ideas about what dark matter might be, and Andy has his new experiment looking for millicharged particles. So you guys know how valuable this is and how it can infuse your whole intellectual life with creativity. Okay, so I said start with a big open question. So a lot of people thought about dark matter. Let me give you an example of a crazy idea people thought of just to set the scale. So people thought, can we use ATLAS essentially as a direct detection dark matter experiment? So you have the ATLAS beam pipe, right? And part of the time when the accelerator is on, they're only shooting one beam. There are no colliding beams, just a single beam. So if we, in fact, live in a dark matter halo, that means that the ATLAS beam pipe is full of WIMPs. And if you're shooting protons through it, occasionally you should have proton-WIMP collisions. And since we have a beautiful detector surrounding this volume, you might be able to detect those recoils and reconstruct these and look for dark matter interactions with normal matter. So we thought, oh, this is a fun idea. So we did the calculations, you know, and we asked this question. Can ATLAS compete with state-of-the-art facilities? You know, we have the materials. Let's figure it out. So we did a calculation. Turns out, you know, we're not sensitive to about 10 to the 18. Okay, that's fine. But, you know, it was a really fun calculation. We had a lot of fun thinking about it. All right, ruled it out. Probably somebody else already had that idea and figured it out, but it was fun. Now, it turns out that that same meeting, two people chose to focus on a different question, which is this one. Who is shooting deadly particles at the Earth? So let me give you a little bit of background on this question before we dive into it, right? And the question is one of understanding the origin of cosmic rays. Okay, so here's a plot from Scientific American. It's fairly old, but it tells the story. It shows you the spectrum of particles coming from space, right? Cosmic rays are just particles from space. And the x-axis here are electron volts. So about 10 to the 16 is about a joule. We're talking about 10 to the 20 electron volts. The y-axis is a logarithmic scale. You see it falls very rapidly. And about above 10 to the 18, or 5 times 10 to the 18, you get about one particle per square kilometer per year. But the range is astonishing, right? It goes up to 10 to the 20 electron volts. And that's really fascinating because there are a lot of questions, simple questions about these particles that are unanswered. What are these particles? Are they mostly protons? Are they heavier nuclei? Where do they come from? What in the universe is making these particles and shooting them at us? If you ask astrophysicists, and I have, what is the highest energy you expect a proton anywhere in the universe to have, right? Kind of a fun question. And you say you can start them off from a supernova, you can whiz them around a black hole, you can use Fermi acceleration to surf, you know, on and gather more energy. You get up to about 10 to the 17, maybe 10 to the 18 EV, right? According to current understanding, there is no process that generates 10 to the 20 EV particles. And yet we see them, right? So if you're looking for a grand open question in physics, here's one that's sending us clues all the time, saying there's something out there you don't understand, right? Even more interestingly, the universe is mostly opaque to particles at this energy. Particles above 10 to the 20 or 10 to the 18 EV see the cosmic microwave background and interact with it, losing energy. So a particle that starts, you can see at 10 to the 22 EV, will fairly rapidly lose energy as it propagates through the universe. Now, fairly rapidly means on astrophysical scales. So you see the axis of this plot here is a megaparsecs, 10, 100 megaparsecs. What this means is on the scale of the universe, ultra-high energy cosmic rays cannot travel very far. So for scale, or they get slowed down. So for scale, our galaxy is about 30 kiloparsecs, and the Virgo cluster is 16.5 megaparsecs. But it means that somewhere in our galactic group, there is a source of these particles, right? The local group is about 3 megaparsecs across. So either there's something fairly close to us, which is shooting particles at us at a reasonably absurd level. Or, since the universe is mostly opaque to these things and slows them down, it could be that the particles are generated much further away at an even more absurd energy, right? We don't know it even to that level. So that means that we can confidently make this statement that there is some unknown nearby object capable of generating particles at this absurd energy, and we just don't know what it is. Okay? What is it that it could be? Well, it could be something new that we haven't seen before, but it's fairly prosaic. A new life, part of a life cycle of a star, or a new kind of astrophysical object that's mostly of interest to astronomers who are interested in the nuts and bolts of how stars work, could be. Other people think more broadly. Here's a paper, for example, from somebody from the Institute for Advanced Study, not a place where you typically have crackpots, suggesting that if aliens are doing particle physics at the Planck scale, that they might produce pollution in the form of very, very high energy particles. Okay? Perhaps. Right? Perhaps. It's certainly fun to think about, right? And I say that not because I believe that theory, but because that's the scale of the possible answers, right? It could be all the way from boring new type of star to crazy aliens sending us messages or polluting the sky, right? So it's a lot of fun to think about these kind of things. So at this meeting, two of us had the same idea. They said, well, let's try to tackle this problem using an existing technology. So this is Chase Shimon, who was my grad student on Atlas, and now he's a postdoc at Yale for Paul Tipton. He's really a rock star. And we thought that we thought about using smartphones, and the basic idea is that your smartphone contains a camera, and a camera is good for taking pictures of your cute kids, but it's also a CMOS device. CMOS devices are sensitive to ionizing radiation and high-energy photons, right? That's how they work. And it's well known that CMOS devices and CCDs can see cosmic rays. Astronomers have been seeing them as a background in their big CCDs for decades. And people have built devices that measure radiation, turning your smartphone into a dosimeter. That is not new. That's been done before. But we thought, if you have enough of these things, can you see cosmic rays at the very high energy and actually network a bunch of these phones together and turn them into a telescope that can extend the reach of existing facilities beyond what's currently capable? So that was the question we asked. The answer, this was 2 years ago, we still don't know why this won't work. Okay? And that is the message I want to give to you today. We are exploring this. We've solved a bunch of fun technical problems. We have a bunch of fun technical problems ahead of us. But so far, we haven't heard a strong argument for why this is impossible. All right. So let's dig into the nitty-gritty. How do you actually do this? Well, first, we have to understand what happens when a cosmic ray hits the Earth. Okay? So a very high-energy particle hits the Earth. It doesn't make it all the way to the ground. It's like a tiny meteorite, right, which burns up on re-entry. One particle hits atmospheric particles, knocks into them, gives more particles, and you start with one particle of very high energy, you end up with a very large number of particles at lower energy. So you have this shock wave which washes over the Earth's surface, into this front, which washes over the Earth's surface. Okay, so that's what we're looking for. What's in these extended air showers? Well, there's lots of particles. They can be very messy. They're full of lots of complicated hadronic interactions. But the things we're interested in are the high-energy photons, the electrons, and the muons. And you can see this is from simulation that the photons go down to very low energies, so down below keV, for example. The electrons peak at 10 keV, and the muons turn on about 1 GeV. And this is for an air shower at 10 to the 19 eV. So we're interested in whether we can see photons, electrons, and muons. And these things mostly happen at the shower core, which is along the direction of the original particle. That's where most of this activity happens. But the scale of these things is incredible, right? Particle physics experiments, we're used to them being big. Atlas is, four stories high. But these effects are on the scale of a kilometer. 1 kilometer away from the original direction of the particle, you're down only an order of magnitude or two in terms of the particle density. So these extended air showers are kilometer in scale. Okay, so how do you see them? Well, you can see them on the ground if you have a detector which is capable of seeing particles. You can also see them in the air because they excite atmospheric nitrogen. You can see the fluorescence, which is a really cool technique. So one of the premier observatories in the world for seeing this is the Auger experiment in South America. And they have 3,000 square kilometers of land, dotted with 1,600, I believe it is, particle detectors, and more than 10,000 cows, though I don't think the cows are instrumented. And the problem is that these particles are very, very rare, right? So down here you have particles 1 per square kilometer per year, right? So in order to see a large number of these particles, you need a very large area, right? And Here's some Auger results. This is slightly out of date, but you can see the point. The circles are areas where cosmic rays came from at very high energy, so above 5 × 10^19. And the question we're asking is, what is the source of these particles? And one clue would be, well, where are they coming from? You see, we just have a handful of events here. There's maybe a dozen or two dozen events. It's not enough to pinpoint and say, oh, they're coming from the centers of galaxies, or they're coming from planets, Earth-like planets orbiting stars, or they're coming from the vicinity of something else, right? We don't even know where in the sky these are coming from, simply because we haven't seen enough examples. Okay. That's a good question. I have to look up the original plot. I don't recall what the shades of blue are. But the point here is it's exposure. Thanks. Right, so you see there are no circles outside that region. This is where Auger can see. So the red are active galactic nuclei, and the question they were asking was, is there an overlap between those two? And so, for example, other people have crazy ideas for what these particles might be. Some people think the universe might be a numerical simulation, and that you could detect this by studying very fast particles that move through the lattices on which the simulation is happening, revealing glitches in the matrix, right? I mean, these are real papers I pulled off the archive. Okay, so how can we answer this question? Which Auger is excellent, it's very high efficiency, but compared to the size of the Earth, it's fairly small, right? It's less than 1/10^5 of the size of the Earth, which means that the cosmic rays are falling on the Earth's surface all the time and being missed. So what could you do? Well, you could build more Augers, right? It works well, it's a nice experiment. You could build more. The problem is that doesn't scale very well with cost. You don't save money by building more of these things. Imagine what you could do if you could cover the Earth, right? Here, if you imagine that you have the complete area of the Earth instrumented, then at these very high energies, you could have millions of particles gathered per year. Right? That's if you could cover the entire Earth. So the volume of data is there, it's just not being captured. Right? So what could you do?
Are you going to tell us everybody's cell phone what the cumulative area is compared to the surface area of the Earth?
What the fractional area covered by cell phones divided by the Earth? I don't have that number for you, but I can tell. At the end I'll show you how many cell phones we need to do science. Well, you know, tentatively. One thing you could do is you could just run for a very long time, right, until your graduate students look like this. But then you'll get in trouble with your union. So imagine you wanted to construct a wish list for your desired cosmic ray experiment, right? You don't have a lot of money, so you need to use existing devices, but you want to cover basically the whole planet. You can't wire these things up, so you need sort of wireless data upload. They need to be remotely programmable, so if you change the way you're doing things, you can communicate with them. And then each one needs to be maintained by somebody who's going to make sure that it's on and powered and doesn't get dropped in the toilet, etc. Okay? This seems like a ridiculous wish list. On the other hand, there is this existing set of devices in everybody's pockets or in everybody's desk drawers at home, which does precisely this, right? So as I said earlier, the camera in your phone is a particle detector. And smartphones have CPUs, they're programmable, they have wireless data upload, and each one has an individual who can maintain it. In addition, the technology that is used to see the particles, this silicon technology, is something that's familiar to us as LHC scientists. We use this silicon in our particle detectors at CERN. So we have some understanding of the basic process that's used to capture these particles. The basic idea is you have the silicon chip. If the camera is covered so that you're not getting ambient light from your sushi lunch or whatever, then and a particle comes through and is incident and deposits energy in the CMOS, what's it going to look like? When you take a picture, it'll look like this. It'll be totally black with a dot of energy where the particle passed through. If you're lucky, you get two or three adjacent dots depending on the grazing angle of the particle. If it's totally perpendicular, you deposit almost all of the energy in one cell. Okay, so that was an exciting idea. We thought maybe this could actually work. Let's figure it out. So I downloaded some Java and figured out how to write an app. Wrote my first app ever and bought some phones on eBay and borrowed some radioactive sources from some of my colleagues and said, can we make this work? And so here's some of the earliest data we got. The x-axis here shows you the pixel response. It's just essentially the ADC counts is 0 to 255. We turn every image into a black and white picture. And the y-axis is the rates, counts per second. The black line you see is what happens when you have no radioactive source. So it falls very quickly. That's how we interpret noise. Then there's a longer tail there that we interpret to be cosmic ray muons. If you bring a radioactive source, each of these give you photons at a range of energy, then you very quickly see additional counts. Right? So this shows us that we are seeing, that our app is seeing real data, and it's actually seeing ionizing particles.
You said photons, no?
Yes, photons.
The radioactive source emits photons?
Yes, these radioactive sources emit photons.
And these cell phones, this is into the...
The camera.
Into the lens of the camera.
That's right, yeah.
Just a little hole.
Just a little bit, yeah. They don't have to go through the lens, right? The lens is irrelevant. It's just the chip behind the lens. And we...
But not refracted by the lens.
No, not refracted by the lens, no. And we did some time variation tests just to convince ourselves it was real. We brought the source close to the phone and saw a lot of hits. Then we brought the phone away, the source away from the phone and saw no more hits. All right, so here you see the number of counts per second in the phone as a function of time, and the shaded regions are when we had the source near the phone. So it's clear we're seeing the data from the phone. Here I can show you a live demonstration we did. Here I have a radioactive source, and this is one of the devices. And I place it on there. And the only active region on the phone is the sensor. And I wrote this live view that shows you a little splash every time a particle comes through. And what I'm showing you here is the CMOS device mapped onto the screen. The screen itself is not the sensitive thing. It's just showing you, just scaling it onto the screen for a visualization effect. So we proved to ourselves we can see photons with the app. We zoomed in on what some of the individual hits looked like, just because we were curious, we're experimentalists. A lot of them looked like these three in the bottom right. They're blobs, where some of the energy, most of the energy is in one pixel, and then some of the adjacent pixels also have some deposition. Occasionally you see a little track here, which we interpret as electrons being knocked off and then wandering through the silicon, which is a lot of fun.
What's the energy response? And which of the wavelength ranges are energy? I mean, that's what I was thinking, of kind of off-the-shelf technology that's not
That's right. So we've tested them with these energies from these radioactive sources, which is in the KeV range. And there's a few there with a variety of energies up to about, I think it's a factor of 100 in the photon range. And then we did some simulation studies using that data to extrapolate how far our sensitivity would be. And we're fairly sensitive across a very broad range with the range that you find in the air showers. But we're not measuring the energy, yeah. We can't measure the energy of the photon, right? And then we thought, well, can we see muons? Let's try to prove that to ourselves. And so here you can see the black spectrum is what we have when we have no source, no radioactive source. Of course, there's a constant stream of cosmic ray muons, which we expect to see. And above this shoulder here, so this we interpreted as noise. Above this shoulder, we see events at exactly the rate you would expect from cosmic ray muons. So we thought, likely that's cosmic ray muons, though that's not exactly convincing evidence. We did some altitude variation studies. Specifically, one of our postdocs took a trip to CERN and back, and on the airplane ran the app on the seat back in front of him in a vertical mode and saw this beautiful track. This is one of our favorite tracks you can see. And if you interpret this as a muon, you can actually measure our muon efficiency per pixel just from this one image. Because you... Just from the image, yeah. This is the...
That's the spatial dimensions of the detector.
That's right, yeah. Which is, you know, this is a quarter of a centimeter and a quarter of a centimeter. So a particle has passed through the silicon chip at exactly the right angle to... Yeah, so it entered... A shallow angle entered here and it left somewhere here, and in between you know there was a particle passing through these pixels, so you can make sort of a skipping stone argument and count the fraction of pixels where you saw the muon, and you can make an estimate of our per pixel muon efficiency, which looks pretty high. And then we had a fortune to do some beam tests. We had some beam tests for other reasons at CERN, and we brought a bunch of phones and we strapped them onto the test calorimeter that's being used, and we saw a lot of nice tracks from the muon beam. You can see this is the beam direction. So we saw a lot of nice tracks, which confirms our understanding of the muons. And we have some tests in process at Davis where we're tagging muons using scintillators. And then we put a phone between them and try to just verify that we can see the same muon. And then we're trying to understand the response of these devices, which is complicated because there's a huge range of devices out there. There's 500 kinds of Android phones. And even among a specific kind of phone, there's various models. And even for a specific model, they will sometimes change the chip that they use. And a lot of the information about these chips is proprietary. And if you look at scanning pictures of some of these chips, the silicon geometry can really change from chip to chip. So one of the challenges is going to be understanding the response of a broad set of different chips that are out there in the wild. So we built a JOMP model of what happens when a photon hits, for example, a piece of silicon. And there's an important difference between the silicon we're using in the phones and the silicon that we have at the LHC. The LHC, we have high voltage. So any time an ionizing particle comes through and creates electron-hole pairs, those are pulled apart and very efficiently gathered. In commercial silicon like this, the electrons just diffuse, and some fraction of them are picked up in the collection region. And this is efficient enough to take pictures of your sushi, but we want a really high-efficiency collection. So we've tried to model this process. A photon comes in, Compton scatters an electron, which then deposits some energy, and those electrons then drift into the collection region. So we have a JOMP model of the device, including all of these effects, and we actually compared it to some of our photon data, and you see that it looks pretty good as a model for what's happening. So we're building some confidence in our understanding of what's happening at the lowest level inside these phones. And so we have an app. The Android app looks like this. And you see that it shows you live pictures of what's happening on your phone. You can even see some data as a function of time as it comes in. And we're working hard on this app. We haven't yet released it in the wild to everybody. And the reason is that we want it to be totally robust before we send it out there, meaning it has to run on 400 different kinds of phones with 10 different versions of the operating system almost under any conditions and be stable for months at a time. This is difficult to do. In addition, we're trying to make it as robust as possible in terms of using a small amount of battery, not heating up your phone, not annoying the user. Because the plan is for people to be using their phones, and then at night, when the phone is idle, that's when we'll take some data. And so we don't want to drain people's batteries or cook their batteries or anything like that. So one of our grad students is working hard on improving the efficiency. He was able to use the GPUs, which now exist on cell phones, to do a lot of the graphics processing and reduce the CPU load by 90-something percent. So we're making important progress there in improving the app. Kyle is working on the iOS version of this app. We got a little grant here to do some development. So we have Android apps and iOS apps. Okay, so we wrote these apps. We showed that you can see some particles. Now to the science question. Can we do science with this, or is it just a fun side project for us? That's the question we set out to answer. So we taught ourselves some things about extended showers and ran some simulations using Corsica. Which describes the lateral distribution of these showers as it comes out of the atmosphere. And what we did is we fit this lateral distribution with a function, and then we did a bunch of simulations where we took phones in a square kilometer area, randomly distributed them uniformly, and then we drew events from these parametric LDFs in order to model the response of the phones. And then for each phone, the probability to see something in your phone is just a product of the area of the phone, the efficiency, per square meter, of course, and then the density of the particles. So the more particles you have, the more likely you are to get a hit in your phone.
It's the area of the chip.
The area of the chip, yes, the sensitive area of the chip. Exactly.
This was a coincidence.
I'm sorry?
This was a coincidence.
Yes, exactly.
How well can you sync up phones temporarily?
Excellent question. I will talk about that in just a moment. The short answer is about 50 to 100 milliseconds. So the probability to see a hit depends on how far you are from the shower core, because it's very sensitively dependent on the particle density, which falls off rapidly as you move away from the core. It's also dependent on the energy of the shower. The higher energy showers have more particles at the surface, so you're just more likely to get a hit. So we fold all of that together, and we're able to calculate the mean number of phones with hits as a function of the primary energy. So the x-axis here is the primary energy, 10 to the 19, 10 to the 20 EV. And these lines grow linearly because as the energy goes up, you have more particles, so higher density, so better chance to see them.
Linearly, this is log-log. So are you saying the slope is 1?
No,
it's
not.
It's just
linear.
How low?
Yeah.
That's what you're saying. Not that it's there's anything linear. It's powerful.
Right. It's a really, it's a log-log relationship.
Matter.
Yeah. Okay. And we have two scenarios here, the open circle and the closed circle, that represent two scenarios for smaller devices and larger devices. One of the biggest uncertainties is not the efficiency per area, but the actual size of the sensitive area. Some of these devices have very, very small CMOS chips, a tenth of a square centimeter. Some of them have larger ones. In fact, the newer phones have larger areas because people want to do better photography. So this represents a range from smaller, less efficient devices to larger, more efficient devices. And then we have a few scenarios for the density of the phones that are being shown, from 500 phones per square kilometer up to 5,000, which is very dense.
You have up there 1 times 10 to the minus 9 and 1 times 10 to the minus 5. What are those things?
Square meters. This is the area times the efficiency. So we're sensitive to the product of the efficiency times the area of the device.
The 10 to the minus 9 is nothing. It's the 10 to the minus 5.
Well, there's 10 to the minus 9 for photons and 10 to the minus 5 for muons. But there are many more photons than muons, so they both contribute.
The efficiencies
are very different for muons and photons, but there are more photons than muons.
What does the mean number of phone hits mean?
So if you, for your given configuration in a square kilometer, this is the number of phones that we expect to see a hit. So a hit is something above threshold. Exactly. So, for example, an excellent scenario is a 10 to the 20 shower with very high density of phones at very high efficiency. You're talking about 100 measurements, right, to characterize the shower. A worse scenario is a lower density of phones with less efficient devices at lower energy. Less than one, for example, phone will be hit. So this tells you, can you see a shower at all? How many phones do you need? What density of phones do you need? And what efficiency of device do you need in order to see phones?
So how do these efficiencies compare to a hydropixel detector like a
Medipixel time
mix?
I don't know the details of those devices, but for example, compare them to particle detectors at CERN, and these efficiencies are low because they have high... Okay, well, those have high voltage, and so they're much more efficient. They're much more efficient at gathering the electrons.
Those have an efficiency of almost one, so how does that compare to that? Is it much, much less?
This is much less, yeah. Plus, these devices are small. And here we're sensitive to the area times the efficiency, right? So you could have a bigger device at the smaller efficiency would be equivalent. These are not designed for this purpose, right? Okay, so are these absurd densities? Why we choose 500 or 5,000 people per square kilometer? Well, what is the density of people on Earth? Well, you ask Wikipedia, what are the densest cities on Earth? And you learn that Manila is an excellent place to do cosmic ray physics, because not only does it have almost 2 million people, but they live at 43,000 people per square kilometer, which is insane. In addition, because Android devices are fairly cheap, the Android penetration of these markets is actually very, very high. So there's a huge number of phones per square kilometer in some of these areas, right?
Does it matter if it's like higher at heights, if it's really kind of skyscrapers, or is it just kind of the area?
No, it does matter the height, because the shower develops, across the ground. It certainly does matter the height, yeah. And if they're stacked on top of each other, that can actually give you very useful information as it develops. So what is the efficiency to see a shower? Well, if you require a minimum of 5 hits, and the more hits you get, the better you can characterize the direction and the angle of the shower. But if you set a minimum at 5, we've done some studies that show that's some reasonable resolution, though not excellent compared to, for example, Auger, just setting 5 as an arbitrary standard, you can calculate the efficiency to detect a shower, and you see that it's very strongly a function of the density and a strongly a function of the energy, which means that what we learned is that we're most sensitive to very high energy showers, which isn't a surprise because that's the showers that have the most particles. On the other hand, those are also the most interesting showers. Those are the ones we have the most questions about. So if you're going to choose between being sensitive to 10 to the 15 or 10 to the 20 EV showers, it's better to be sensitive to the very high energy showers. Although being sensitive to 10 to the 15 is useful because there are a lot more of those, and you could use those to characterize and calibrate your detectors. In addition, we also study the efficiency as a function of the number of users, or the user density, right? So here, the x-axis is now log base 10 of users per square kilometer, right? So this means 100 people per square kilometer, 1,000 people per square kilometer. And these curves show you the efficiency turn on for various energy scenarios. So the green is 10 to the 20 EV. That's the one we're most interested in. And these, again, are the two efficiency scenarios, so high efficiency or low efficiency devices. Best case scenario, very high energy showers, very high efficiency devices, you see that you need somewhere between 100 and 1,000 people per square kilometer is where the turn on is. Less efficient devices, the turn on is about 1,000 people per square kilometer.
This is the average over the whole Earth.
This is for users per square kilometer,
yeah,
in one square kilometer.
No, I understand, but assuming that there is that average everywhere and you're adding up.
No, I'm just considering, I'm not adding anything up, I'm just considering a single square kilometer. But here is the distribution of people on Earth. The blue line shows you the actual distribution of how people live. So how many, the scale is relative, right? This is not per shower efficiency, but it shows you the distribution of how people live. A lot of people live in 100 square kilometers or less. Very few people live in 10,000 square kilometers, 10,000 people per square kilometers or more. But this is the how the distribution falls.
You're looking at 1 kilometer.
Yeah.
You're sort of imagining you're treating people within 1 kilometer, but you said before that these showers are spread over a larger area than that. So how does this change if you imagine that it's spread over?
I think the missing part was that you're assuming that the showers, that there is a shower centered on that.
Yeah.
School, but I don't know if you.
Oh, I see. Right. Yeah. So if you shoot a shower at a square kilometer, and then you have this number of devices in there, what's your efficiency to capture it?
Yeah,
that's what we're asking.
Also, in that kilometer, or this is imagining
in that kilometer,
in,
yes.
But then you could ask the same question, what if you had 10 kilometers?
Yeah, well, it falls off fairly, I mean, it does extend that far, but the efficiencies are pretty low beyond a kilometer because it falls off by more than two orders of magnitude, and so you don't gain much by having more than a square kilometer. On the other hand, we're not going to partition people into square kilometers, right? People live in continuous regions. We've done the calculation both ways, where you just assume square kilometers and also where you account for the neighboring squares, you don't gain much from the neighboring squares.
So the motivation is OG is great, but it only covers a small fraction of surface area. The Earth is large, a lot of cell phones. But if in fact this only works in very high density areas where people have a lot of cell phones, then what is the actual area that's available for this?
Right, good. So the point that this makes is where is it useful? Into what low density is it useful, right? For very high energy showers and efficient devices, it's not only areas at 10 to the 4 or 10 to the 3, 500 people per square kilometer can contribute, and there are a lot of places on the Earth with that density.
Well, but that's 500, that's population density, not density of people with cell phones who have signed up who are asleep at that time.
That's right, absolutely. This just gives us the scale, right? So, I'll get to that question. How do we actually see these showers, and what can we do with that? it's a difficult reconstruction problem. Auger has a nice detector. They have this regular grid and picosecond timing. They can see a shower washing over their device, which get some directionality. We don't do that. We have an irregular network. We have maybe 100 millisecond timing. So what we actually do is we measure the hit density, which is proportional to the particle density, and then we connect the particle density to the initial energy of the incident particle. We look at the eccentricity of the deposition to give the theta, and then the major axis will give us the phi. Here's an example from Auger. You can see that there really is an ellipse on the ground that's hit. Let me get to your timing question. We studied whether or not two phones can actually deliver a coincidence. We had this setup where we have a computer with an LED blinking at two different phones, a randomly blinking LED, and we measured the capture time. What we found was that the differences in timing between the phones was up to about a second if you just use the naive cell tower time, because the cell tower time is very inaccurate. But these phones have three different ways to measure time. They have relative time on the device. There's NTP servers that you can ping, and they have the cell phone time. tying all of those things together, we're able to get about 100 millisecond timing. And so our initial calculation was that if we spread the devices uniformly, okay, so not according to the way they actually are on Earth, but just as an exercise in our mind, if we could build these devices and spread them out uniformly, how many would we need? Is the answer we need 1,000? Is it we need 1,000,000? Is it we need 10 trillion? Just to get a scale of the problem. And in this paper, we said that we needed a few million devices if uniformly displaced and running 24/7. Obviously not a realistic scenario, but not so far from realistic that we thought it was not worth showing. We built a little collaboration. We have some people at UCI, Kyle here at NYU, people at Davis, and some people at Yandex in Russia, and some people in China. And then the question was relevant. Then the relevant question was, what fraction of people do you need to participate in order to make this useful science, right? So that was the question I think you asked. And I was here a couple of years ago presenting this, and I think Michael asked me that same question, or it was Neil or somebody did. He said, how many people do you need to contribute given the actual distribution of people on Earth, right? And so we were doing that calculation. In the meantime, Michael and Glenn has put out a paper doing a similar calculation. So here's from their paper on the archive. This is the fraction of participants. So this is everybody. This is 10%. This is 1% of people. And they calculated the effective area. We didn't give a whole lot of information in our initial paper, so they made some simplifying assumptions, saying that you only can see things above 1,000 people per square kilometer or 5,000 per square kilometer. And so they did these calculations. And compared to Auger, for example, they find you need 10% participating population, which is a bit discouraging. But again, they made these assumptions that you can only see things if you have 1,000 per square kilometer or 5,000, which are extraordinarily dense regions.
If you see the things, whether the resolution.
Yes, that's right. And
what do you want to do? Would you use these events
at 100% energy resolution? I'd be happy to have a device that was sensitive at 10 to the 21 with 100% energy resolution, yes. I think that would be quite interesting. Yeah. I think
the totally dominated by things that way below the GBA cutoff, but just so much more.
And it's a very steep spectrum you're aware of, right?
That's right.
So yes. I think this 1,000 square kilometers receives a 30% energy resolution point of view. I think it's a very reasonable assumption. Because you don't want to go on the table of your efficiency.
I think the point is to explore the capabilities of this device, and that's what we're doing. And if it's a if what we need is more devices to get more energy resolution, then so be it. I think the question we're trying to answer is, what can we do with the existing set of devices? Not, I think that's the question we're trying to answer. And so there's this calculation. We did a calculation as well, because there are lots of regions below 1,000 people per square kilometer or 5,000 people per square kilometer where there's significant contributions. And you can take a sharp threshold, which I think is fairly conservative, but this turn-on curve is quite broad, and there's a lot of people. This distribution here falls very rapidly. And so if you only consider extraordinarily dense regions, then you're cutting off a lot of your potentially sensitive area, which is fine. And so we've done a calculation as well. And so here, I'm sorry? In this case, we've defined it as 5 phones. That's right. I'm sorry? It's a. Perhaps we can talk about the technical details afterwards, but the goal here is to measure it for 5. You can also set a threshold at 10. You know, it's an arbitrary distinction, and you can get whatever resolution you like, more efficiency or less efficiency. Here, we're interested in calculating, again, the capability of the device, right? And the efficiency, you can get certainly better resolution for more devices, right? But I think you're interested in seeing these events, even if they come in. And I'm not, I'm not making claims about the resolution here. And so we asked this question, I think this is a really interesting question, which is the relevant question, which is what fraction of global users do you need to run your app in order to do some science, right? This is the question we set out to answer. And so here's the Auger effective area in blue. And so if you actually convolute those two distributions, the distribution of the density of people on the Earth with the turn-on curve that we quoted, you see that for 1% global user adoption, you have a pretty nice device for very, very high energy cosmic rays. Here at lower energy, 10 to the 18, you have very little efficiency. Even 10%, even a 10% global user adoption, which is a very, very high number, you're not very good at seeing 10 to the 18 showers. You're excellent at seeing 10 to the 20 showers, right? So the strength of this is certainly at the very highest energies. And then we ask the question, well, are people in the plains of Nebraska really contributing much, right? Should we really be counting those people? And so we said, we did another calculation. Yeah, good question. And so then we asked another question. We said, what if we only focus on areas where people are very dense, right? Only areas like Manhattan or very dense cities. And you see that most of the sensitivity is, in fact, coming from the densest areas, right? And if you only focus on these areas, then you get most of your interest. And it turns out, actually, that you can get a lot of power not from uniformly distributing the cosmic ray devices, but from building clusters. So, for example, I haven't shown you the plots here. If you clump people together, 30 phones per in a classroom, for example, you can get a really significant resolution and efficiency. And for example, if you calculate how many clusters do you need of 30 phones in order to get scientific power, then you come up with a number which is roughly equivalent to, for example, the number of high schools in the United States. So this is exquisitely sensitive to the placement of the phones, meaning you need a certain minimum density in order to get anything. You can construct those densities by getting high schools to pull them together or by just trying to flood the market and competing with Pokemon Go, exactly as he suggests. Now, I am not making a claim that we will get 10% global user adoption or 100% or even 1%. The question we're asking is, what level of adoption do you need in order to do some science? And to me, the question was, is it more than the existing number of phones, or is it ten to the five phones? And that was the question we set out to ask, answer. And in this business, we're categorizing the questions into two types of questions, okay? One type of question are questions that if you had 10 times or 100 times as many devices, they would solve themselves. And this is the questions that the comments in the audience have focused on. How good are you at seeing showers? What is the resolution of those showers? If you had 10 times as many devices, some of those questions would go away. Now, the thing is, the number of devices is growing very quickly, and they're appearing in all sorts of new areas. You have them on your laptop, you're getting them in your refrigerators to measure the amount of milk you're drinking, these kind of things. We're primarily focused on the other kind of questions, the killer questions, where the problems cannot be solved by adding more phones. So, for example, can you have adequate timing resolution? Can you build a reasonable efficiency per phone? Can you minimize the power consumption? Can you calibrate an individual device? Every device has a completely different response. So these are the questions we're focusing on, because those are the killer questions that would make it totally impossible to do the project, even if you had 100% user adoption across the globe, which is certainly unlikely. That's right, yeah.
So do you know are they going to use CMOS? Are those CMOS the same size that are new cell phone? Are they bigger? Because obviously a bigger object, you don't care about having to be quite small.
That's right. So those devices are similar in size, right? Because like the camera that you have in the back of the car while you're backing up, you know, those cameras are similar in size. And these cameras are very cheap. You know, you can go on Amazon and buy 1,000 of them at 7 cents each or something like that. So they're being added all over the place to electronics. You could make clothing out of them, yes, I suppose. There's probably already somebody in New York City wearing one.
It seems like there's kind of two ideas. One is that cheap CMOS detectors can detect particle waves. And the other is that cheap CMOS detectors are in cell phones and broadly available. Right? But cheap CMOS detectors are cheap, and maybe a lot of these problems with timing and calibration and placement and density and all this would be solved if you just use like a moat network or some wireless network and said, you know what, rather than try and make people's cell phones work for us, we'll spend 7 cents a sensor and just, you know, spend $1,000 per site or something. Right? Why is cell phones the right way to do this?
It's a great question. There are already projects like that, projects where you can download the bits you need to build a little scintillator to do cosmic ray studies, and you can tie all of those together. The costs scale with the number of devices. And if you want to ask this question, can we build a telescope which can do science that can extend the reach of current facilities, then the costs become prohibitive. Here we're asking the question, can we piggyback on existing devices because the cost, the money's already been spent. I think both questions are interesting.
There's a marginal cost in advertising, right? You know, early adopters, I think, but to reach those kind of levels of saturation that you're talking about, I think it's unrealistic to say that that doesn't scale with the number of devices.
Sure, I'm not saying that it's realistic to get 50 million people to run the app. I'm certainly not saying that at all. I'm not making any argument about the likelihood of achieving a user base. I'm asking the question, if we had that user base, could we do science? Which I think is the first question to ask before we decide to spend any money on marketing an app. Right? And I think that's the question we're still trying to figure out the answer to. But I think both approaches are reasonable. Small dedicated devices and cell phones. And the other thing is you can tie all of these together. If, as we're doing, you use a likelihood to evaluate these things, and you can have an inhomogeneous network including all sorts of different kinds of devices. So you don't need to focus only on one. So then the question is, what kind of user base is reasonable? Okay. Well, this we don't know. How excited are people in doing astrophysics with their phones? How many phones are there out there? Here's a projection from 2012 that suggested the number of global internet devices would be at 2.5 billion in 2016. Well, last year I read articles suggesting there were already 3.5 billion. So this optimistic projection from 2012 undershot the number of internet devices by a billion. Okay, so we certainly it's clear that the number of devices is growing very rapidly. What fraction of those people are willing to contribute their phones to do astrophysics? I don't know the answer to that question. And I agree it's critical, but that's something we don't know yet.
Are there privacy considerations?
There are deep privacy considerations. Because in order to calibrate a device, you need to know its history. You need to know where it's been, where it is, because every location for that device will have a different response. Absolutely. Another challenge, the devices exist, but there's an important challenge, a financial challenge, in terms of gathering the data. You can't send all of this data to one desktop in Irvine. I've tried that. It doesn't work. You need a cloud-based data acquisition system to gather this data, because you want a small lag time across the world. And even if you're very stingy with the amount of data you're uploading per device, as we are, it grows quickly with the number of devices. And that's not a trivial cost. So for example, it could cost thousands of dollars per month to run a million devices. Amazon has been very generous, and they are hosting our data acquisition system currently for free, which is very nice. And Chase and some of the other grad students who know how to use all of these fancy tools have built a data acquisition system for us in the cloud, which gathers data. I'm running out of time, so I'll skip quickly through some of this. And we have distributed the app to about 1,000 or 2,000 people around the world to do testing and see what is the spectrum like, how does the app perform, gather some initial response. And so we just like scan through phones to see what kind of data we get. A lot of it is very noisy, but you can remove a lot of that noise pretty quickly. You can get some different spectra for different kind of devices and see different kinds of responses per device. But it's clear that if we ever do this, we have a significant calibration challenge because every device has to be understood. We're going to be looking for noise above the typical response for that kind of device, which is a difficult challenge. And there are other challenges I didn't even have a chance to mention. For example, atmospherics. If we have a global network which can see these showers, that's great, but the development of the showers depends on the temperature and the pollution and all sorts of complicated things that are happening in the air, which we might not necessarily have any data about. We need to calibrate each device, and we prefer to avoid using simulation to model all of these phones. You can imagine calibrating these things in situ. If you have a model for what the local radiogenic backgrounds are and the cosmic ray rates, you can understand what those spectra look like and find data that matches that to calibrate it. There's a complicated question about overburden. The electron component of the shower depends a lot on how much concrete there is between you and the initial shower. And that is difficult to model. It's not anything we necessarily have data about. So you can imagine people in Manhattan apartment building, each one has fewer layers of concrete between them and the initial particle. If we don't have an accurate estimate of the height, then it'd be difficult to disentangle that information. We have a lot of user challenges. Even if we could prove that we could do science with a certain number of devices and overcome all of the technical challenges. We need to get people to run the app, which is a challenge. We had a bit of press when we put out the paper, and we had 50,000 people sign up in just a few days, and by now it's a little more than 100,000 people who are interested in the app. That's a nice set of people. It's not nearly enough to do real science with, but it's a good start. We have ideas for how to make it easy for people to use. For example, you don't need to run it on your existing phone. You could run it on a phone that you have sitting in your desk that you're not using currently, and that you could use 24/7. A lot of people have an old phone in their desk that they're not using, the previous model. So the app is free, of course. It's easy to install. It should launch itself. It does. It turns itself on if it notices that the phone has not been used for more than a minute and that the camera is dark. Because we think that if people do adopt the device, the phone, the app on their device, they'll be interested for a few minutes, maybe a day, and then they'll get bored with it. So we want to make sure that it's very low burden for them. It should never annoy them. But we started this project wondering, what can we do with the existing set of devices? And so we're having fun thinking about it. We're hoping that maybe we can actually do some science. You know, we have some high targets. the highest energy target cosmic ray ever observed is 10 to the 20. If we ever get to build this thing, you know, we might see something about 10 to the 21. The most expensive experiment ever so far is the LHC. But people have already spent something like $500 billion on the network of smartphones that are out there. So if we could tap into that existing set of devices, that would be pretty awesome. The LHC also holds the record for the longest author list. And we imagine if we get people to contribute, you know, we might as well put everybody as an author on the paper. So go for 1 million authors. So in conclusion, this is an important mystery in physics, right? It's an enduring mystery. It's something that's fascinating. We'd love to have the answer to. And we know that this existing network of mobile devices might have power to help us answer these questions. But of course, there are very important questions that remain. Technological questions, sociological questions that remain unsolved. So thank you very much for your attention.
Not just getting them excited, but getting them excited and having something, you know, that comes from it.
We're certainly working our hardest to make something come from it, but thanks for the support. Yeah.
And the other piece on that theme is, if you haven't yet, we calculated the power consumption, and it's really a substantial drain and you know, consumption in terms of CO2 emission and so on. But the thinking of, about your basic problem of how to reconstruct the cosmic rays, one of the things that got me thinking about, which is I'd love to get you guys thinking about it too, because I think there's a really interesting science project that could be done. It's not known what the inner structure is of these events.
I agree.
And so one of the problems you would have is if you see something, you have no idea how to actually map it, even if it weren't for the resolution. Even if you have perfect resolution, you don't have a way to connect that to the energy of the primary without extreme reliance on models that are very, very uncertain.
Absolutely.
But
that's the point I was making here.
What I would say would be a wonderful project. Then maybe you can see a way to do. When I've thought about it and talked to people, it didn't seem like smartphones would be the way, but maybe you can, you know, be more creative. What would be a wonderful project is to figure out a way to put a density, 1,000 per square kilometer, let's say, across the OJ array, because then you could have a situation where your devices would let you sample in detail this part of the shower that OJ can't look at because it gets overly saturated and doesn't have adequate spatial resolution. Because what would make that so interesting is that super inner part, for everybody else in the audience who's not thinking about this, that super inner part is almost a direct descendant of the initial collision, because those are the parts of the event that are most collinear and are carrying And the reason they're collinear is because they had the highest energy after the first interaction. So you would really have access in a really direct way to a kind of physics that's not accessible otherwise, that's otherwise very sort of indirectly accessible. So if you could figure out a way, the problem seems to be keeping them powered. The thing your users are doing for you is they're keeping them plugged in. And doing that every 40 meters out in the middle of the pampas would be an incredible expense, unless
I agree. I think an excellent way to do calibration would be cross-calibration with other detectors, and so yes. The OJ infill area would be perfect. But
not
as you say,
calibration, but also simply science, where
absolutely.
You know a lot more about the event.
I agree. Yeah, no. This could give you a very rich measurement of the lateral distribution. It could help validate some of these models and help us understand how to calibrate it. I completely agree. That would be fantastic. I'll look into that. It's an interesting idea, but we don't have a whole lot of low-level access to these devices, and there's a lot of processing. In fact, a whole problem that we're dealing with that I didn't even get a chance to mention is how to unravel what processing happens between the raw collection of data and the delivery of the image to the app. And a lot of times, there's even error correction and noise cancellation, which can reduce the existence of a signal itself. So we don't have a lot of, unfortunately, low-level access to the raw data. To even answer more basic questions than the one you've asked. Not yet.
You mentioned briefly using phones that are encouraged as other phones, like don't they have to be connected to the network if you get the data?
Sure. But if you have an old phone in your house and you plug it in and it connects to your Wi-Fi, that's not a problem. And so there, for example, you might have two or three phones per person. Right? I mean, a lot of people have an old phone that they're not using. And we've worked hard to reduce the battery consumption.
Or if you donate them, then it's a fine idea, because then you start getting these clusters.
Right.
50 phones, 50 phones, and they're actually locally sensitive.
Donate them to what?
High schools.
If they're donated, like you have an older phone, instead of recycling it, you donate it to the high school, and then the science club.
Oh, yeah.
And try to get some internet, Verizon or whatever, to donate the...
The internet's not a problem.
So you just need a
wireless. Oh, you do it.
Okay. Yeah, you do it.
Probably old phones have sensors that are better for you because, right, one of the optimizations people made is get the detector smaller, right, and higher pixel density that you don't want. Right?
Some of them. There's something of a minimum, though. There was an optimization to make them smaller, and then consumers seem to want bigger devices, and so they're actually growing again.
They're getting bigger.
Yeah. So there was a period there, like 2012, where they're the worst, and now they're getting better again. Yeah.
We're just throwing on solicited suggestions.
Thank you. Yes.
Go to Apple or someone and say, can you get 10,000 old phones, right, that no one's using, and just set this up yourself, where you can calibrate and have control and replace it everything, and see if you can see anything instead of saying, what do 50,000 random people do, right? That would be even your best case in terms of solving all the other problems.
We've tried that.
The flux of the events at 10 to the 20th is 1 per square kilometer per century. So they would have to wait a century.
And we tried that. And the thing is that these refurbished phones are worth money, right? Each one is worth $100 or $200. So it's a significant donation.
No one would give us anything like our old iPad, like our first iPad.
Well, then you can give it to me. I'll take it. Thanks.
You can imagine maybe trying to do a public health thing about radiation background. Have you thought about that?
We certainly have.
What's that? Why is that so funny?
No, there's nothing funny about this. Actually, radon is a big killer.
Yeah.
Radon is a big killer, and using it as a dosimeter is a real possibility. There are actually a lot of legal issues there. A lot of companies have patented that idea, and so if we do it, we could be cutting into their market share. But it's interesting, absolutely. And so, you know, I think to sum up, there are questions: is this technically possible? And we set out to answer: how many phones would you need? What fraction of people would you need to do any science? And you could argue about the quality of science you could do. But I think it could certainly add to existing facilities. And then there's a completely separate question of whether it's practical to get that many people involved. And that is a question that's sociological that I don't have the answer to. But I would hate to turn off the idea just because we were afraid that people might not get involved. So thanks again for your attention.
Great.